Thank you. Grace and peace to you. It is good to gather here in God's house or online. We are glad to worship with you as well. If you are worshiping with Amity that way, it is good to gather together to praise God on this Sunday morning. I want to draw your attention to the announcements on the back of the bulletin. Lots to take note of there. Today we're collecting our 10 cents a meal offering, which is a special offering that stays local in the Charlotte Presbytery to feed hungry folks and to support programs that serve at-risk youth. So give joyfully and freely to that as you give to the church today. I also want you to know that next Sunday, April 3rd, you are invited to bring a lunch, pack a lunch box, bring a bag lunch. And we're going to gather down in the fellowship hall and eat together. Just a time of fellowship. We haven't gotten to do that much lately because of COVID and all its joys. But we are going to do it next Sunday. So please bring a lunch. Maybe pack an extra sandwich or something for folks who might show up and not know that we're having lunch. But you're invited to do that so we can celebrate together and enjoy each other's company. And following lunch, we are going to begin a few of our ministry teams, the new teams that we all signed up for and learned about a couple weeks ago. A few of those teams are going to meet to begin their work after lunch next Sunday. But whether you signed up for a team or not, everyone is invited and encouraged to come to lunch. There will be some other good information shared with you that day. All right. As you can see, we have moved, as of today, to a mask optional policy. Masks are still welcome and encouraged for those who feel more comfortable in them. We have plenty of seating. If you still would like to keep your distance a little bit. You are welcome to worship however you feel comfortable. And please, we just ask that you consider others if you're not feeling well. Maybe wear a mask or stay home that day, either one. use your best judgment of how to care for those around you. It is good. It is good to be together. Let's do our best to keep it that way. All right, friends. Let's go from getting to this place this morning to being here, to being with God. And let's chime the hour and turn to God in worship.
Good morning. I invite you to rise and join in the call to worship. We've come to hear the stories of our generous and compassionate God.
We've come to share the stories of God's love and mercy in our own lives.
God is teaching us to be witnesses to that love in the world.
God is teaching us to be generous, personal, and compassionate to others.
Church, are you ready to be changed?
Come, Holy Spirit, and make us new. Let us pray. Holy and loving God, here we are again on another Sunday, hoping to meet you again and meet you anew. In the stories of Scripture and in the stories of your people, in this and every time and place, help us to see the way that you weave your presence throughout our days. And in this time of worship, give us the grace to see one another and ourselves as you do. And give us the grace to stay a while in the shadow of your wings. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, let's sing joyfully the hymn that is on the inserts in your bulletin, Oh, How I Love Jesus.
I love Jesus.
seated. Oh, how I love Jesus because he first loved me. Friends, no matter the state of our lives, no matter the number of times that we have messed up or gotten it all wrong, Jesus loves us first and always and extends that amazing grace to us even before we realize that we need it. And yet, it is still true that we try to distance ourselves from God and from one another. And though we cannot lose God's love at church, there are still places in our lives in need of repair. That's why we confess our sin each week in worship. We name it. We name it without shame or fear. And we name it with hope. With hope in our God who has made us, who knows us, and who loves us, and who makes all things new. So church, bring your confessions and lay them down at your Savior's feet. Let us pray first through singing together. Let us make our confession. Loving God, whenever selfishness blinds us to the needs of others, forgive us. Whenever we forget who our neighbor is, forgive us. Whenever we pass by on the other side, forgive us. Whenever we neglect saying, I love you, forgive us. Whenever we forget to simply give thanks, forgive us. Whenever we lose our way, forgive us. For all those times, we bring a tear to your eye, bring us back into your forgiving arms, and teach us your way once again. We offer you the truth of our lives in this quiet moment. Amen. Beloveds, let the waters of baptism remind you that you have been claimed by God in Jesus Christ, God who loves you and forgives you. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old has passed away and the new has come. Join me in the words of assurance. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Alleluia. Amen. Let us sing of how Jesus loves us as children come forward to the front. Again. Today, we are going to hear a story. We're all going to hear a story from Scripture that Jesus told. Jesus taught through stories. Do you remember what the word for those stories is that Jesus told? It starts with a P. Prayers. Sometimes prayers can be we tell our story to God. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Prophecy, good guess. That's another good biblical word about speaking what God gives you to speak. A story that Jesus told, he told parables. And that's a story that he told to teach us something about God, okay? And so what we're going to hear in a little bit is a story that Jesus told about a man with two sons. And one son, it wasn't time for him to get his inheritance, his blessing, his inheritance from his dad. That means the money that he was going to inherit to keep, to live on, to support his family. He didn't want to wait. He wanted it now, and he wanted to take it, and he wanted to go and spend it all. And that's what he did. He left his family, and he spent all his money doing all kinds of things that he probably should not have been doing. And then all of a sudden, he realized he had nothing left, and he had to come back home, and he was afraid. He was afraid that his dad would be really mad and not welcome him back home. But what did his dad do? Do you know the story? It's a great story. His dad saw him coming from way far away, and he ran to him, and he embraced him, and he hugged him, and he welcomed him home, and then he threw a giant party. And Jesus tells us that story to tell us what God is like. That God is like that Father, who no matter how far we run, no matter how we mess up, always, God is always excited to welcome us home and back into God's arms, and with joy, right? Now, we hear a lot God talked about like Father, right? We hear Father, Son, Holy Spirit, right? And there's wonderful things about fathers that are true about God. But is God a boy or a girl? They. God is not a human like us, right? So gender, it's kind of hard. It's hard to know. God doesn't have one or the other. God is bigger than gender. But we talk about God as Father a lot. But we can also talk about God as Mother and the good things that mothers can teach us about love. So I want to read you this book called Mother God. And in it, I want you to notice what you see and what you hear about the way that God loves us. Sometimes it's like a father, sometimes it's like a mother, sometimes it's both of those things. Sometimes fathers and mothers love the same way. You know God the Father, but God is your mother too. You are made in her image. She is making all things new. Waiting for new life to begin, God is a mother in labor. She takes deep breaths until the birth, rejoicing with friend and neighbor. Throughout day and night, God wakes to nurse the infant at her side. She snuggles her baby gently until he closes his sleepy eyes. When baby tumbles on the floor, God pulls off each tiny sock. She holds her arms out wide, and the baby learns to walk. God is Sophia, wisdom. Teaching what is true and right, wisdom works, creates, orders, and plays. She calls us with joy and delight. Over the waters of creation, God is the Spirit who hovers. She forms the earth into a bed and the wide sky its covers. God is a mother hen who gathers chicks under her wings. She plays hide and seek in soft grass behind trees and quiet springs. She protects her cubs from danger. God, the great mother bear, as fierce as she is tender, she guards them in her care. God is a lurking leopard, secretive, skilled, and strong. Teaching her young to swim and climb, she roars and they tag along. With a huge supply of flour, God kneads and bakes good bread. She feeds her entire neighborhood. They feast and all are fed. God is a skillful seamstress who stitches and sews thread together. She makes clothes for rain and snow, caring for you in all kinds of weather. Granny, Baba, Halmeoni, God is a woman with gray hair. She passes down stories of old, rocking softly in a chair. She is the God who sees you. God weeps, mourns, and cries. She comforts you through the longest night, keeping watch until sunrise. She quiets us with her songs, singing lullabies in the night. God, our nurturing mother, wraps us in holy moonlight. God is your loving mother. You are made in her image too. God calls you beloved. She is making all things new. The end. I want you to remember, God is your parent. And even when earthly mothers and daddies, even when our moms and dads mess up, God's love never goes away. Okay? Let's say a prayer. Dear God, thank you for loving us, protecting us, and providing for us. Help us to love too, just like you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can go back to your seat or to the very back. I didn't tell you I was going to do something else. I'm surprising you, Jill. Sorry about that. There is an incredible ministry in Los Angeles, California, called Homeboy Industries. And it was started by a priest named Father Greg Boyle. And some of you went with me a couple years ago to hear him speak downtown. Homeboy Industries, it's the largest gang rehabilitation program and re-entry program in the entire world. Over 30 years that they have been operating, they have helped thousands of people break free from the cycle of gang violence and incarceration in LA and now around the world. They provide resources like job training, tattoo removal, which is important in gang life, parenting classes, all sorts of education, and most importantly, I think, they offer hopeful, genuine, faith-filled community where people know that they are valued and loved and they have worth and they belong outside of their gang. And each morning at their headquarters, before they begin the day, the staff there, which are mostly former gang members, the homies, that's what they call those who are coming to receive services and find community, anyone who happens to be there, they begin their day with a morning meeting. And part of that is they have a thought for the day that is shared by someone in the community. It might be a story or a personal testimony or a bit of wisdom that person has learned and wants to share. And so this morning, we are going to hear from Mariana. And she is going to tell us a part of her story that she calls being in the midst of her storm. And she shares how one job rejection letter almost undid all the progress that she had made to get her life on track. But then she'll share how she saw God's hand in all of that on the other side.
Take over. Mariana Ruiz, give us the thought for the day. Hey.
In the midst of my storm, I kind of learned to tune into Caleb. And Caleb, there's a song by Casting Crowns. It's called Just Be Held. And it says, I got really nervous. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. So, it took me, as I was listening to it, I could relate it to a lot of things that I've gone through in my life, right? But I'm only gonna share one in particular thing, because it's a really long story, but at one point in my life, I had just completed treatment, I was managing a sober living, I was doing everything I had to do, complying with parole, I was navigating the bus system pretty good, you know, I knew how to get from A to B, on the trains and buses, and I had just got my kid back. I had applied for a job at USC. Everything was going good, right? And then I got that rejection letter from USC. Even though they had sent me an offer, they told me at this point we can't hire you because you have a criminal background. So then my prep cook job let me go, they laid me off. Then I had no business managing a sober living, so thank God they let me go, but at the time it just felt like my life was falling apart, right? And I was walking into places, submitting my applications, and just felt like my mistakes had been written all over my face. Like I was a failure, right? Like everything on my record, everything I'd done, getting my kids taken, the drugs, everything that I'd been convicted, it was written all over my face. And at some point I just fell on my knees and I'm like, what's my next move? I don't want to get loaded. About a year and a half clean, I don't want to get loaded. I don't want to go back to being the person that I was, so what do you want from me, God? So I walked into Homeboy Industries. It opened up a world of opportunities. No more looking for jobs on buses. You know, you guys helped me get a driver's license, helped me get a car, helped me get my GED, helped me close out my DCFS case. All of the blessings just started raining down on me, right? And that letter that made me feel like my world was falling apart, it was my golden ticket. I took it to court. And because of that letter showing that it was becoming a nuisance in my life, my record was a barrier now, trying to move forward, and it's holding me back, they were able to dismiss my record. My world wasn't falling apart, even though that's what I felt like it was. And I'm gonna leave you with these last lyrics from that song. If your eyes are on the storm, you'll wonder if I love you still. But if your eyes are on the cross, you know I always have and I always will. And not a tear is wasted. In time, you'll understand. I'm painting beauty with the ashes. Your life is in my hands.
I know that was hard to understand in here with our acoustics, I'm realizing. She shared how, as she was coming out of gang life and getting her life back on track and working hard to find a job, she'd gotten her kid back, she said. She had gotten a car. And she'd applied for a job. And she thought all was going well, and then she received a letter of rejection for the place that she had applied for the job. And they said, we can't hire you because of your criminal background. And she thought, I'm never going to get anywhere because that's going to follow me. And she thought it was all falling apart. But because of that letter, she walked into Homeboy Industries, and they met her with resources, with training, with community, helped her wipe her record clean through the resources that they had to do that. And she was able to get a job. She was able to get back on track. And so she says, sometimes out of the ashes, God creates beauty, and you can't see it until you're on the other side. So that was Mariana's story. Let's turn to scripture.
The first scripture reading comes from Paul's letter to a young pastor named Timothy and to the church he was helping lead in Ephesus. Our passage for today is 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 17. Listen for God's word. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. There is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen.
Let's go to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verses 1 through 3, and then beginning in the second half of verse 11 through 32. Listen again for God's word. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Verse 11, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and he set off for a distant country, and there he squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the land, in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and he hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.'" So he got up and he went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Bring a ring and put it on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. And meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "And your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I have been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But with this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, when he comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. Church, this is the word of God, and it is for you, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Like Mariana at Homeboy Industries, like Paul the Apostle, like the prodigal son of Jesus' parables, we all have a story. Most of us have more than one. And like any good story, each of ours has some essential story elements. It has the characters. It has a setting. It has a plot. But no story is really good unless there are these two other elements, the conflict and the resolution, a before and an after. You see, before Mariana was a living testimony to the transforming power of the loving community that she found at Homeboy Industries. She was a gangbanger in the throes of addiction and hopelessness. And before the prodigal son was embraced and forgiven by his abundantly gracious father, he was an impatient, wasteful, reckless squanderer. And before Paul became Paul, apostle for Jesus Christ, well, he was Saul, the persecutor of Christians, Saul, the zealous, ruthless, violent terror. When I come to these stories, I come as a human being, bringing with me my own story. And as I read or listen to these voices, I sort of lay my own story over top of theirs to find the places where they meet, where they cross, where they overlap. And then I notice the places, the parts that seem as distant as the sun is from the earth, and I wonder at the marvel that is the human experience. And this is what we all do when we hear another's story, whether we are aware of it or not. We see ourselves there. When you hear Mariana's story, you may not know the experience of feeling trapped in gang life, though many do. You may not know that particular experience, but there is not a human alive that has never felt hopeless. We all have that experience where the letter, whatever it is, when the letter comes in the mail and it seems like everything we have worked for is about to fall apart. Have you had that moment? Maybe you have had many of those moments. I have. But I pray and I hope that you also share Mariana's experience of making it through and being able to look back and see God's hand in your struggles and in your deliverance, as she said, to see God's beauty in the ashes. Maybe in your life you have not squandered or wasted the family inheritance that you selfishly demanded from your loved ones. Or maybe that's pretty close to your story. I'd say it's more common than most of us would like to think. I look back at my early young adult life, post-college, pre-kids, pre-mortgage, pre-car payments, and I wonder what in the world I spent all my money on. Then I remember that if yesteryear's karaoke bar was still standing here on the corner of Sharon Amity and Independence Boulevard, I could probably ask them and they would hand me an itemized list. We have all squandered the blessings in our life at one time or another. Maybe you've never had a financial inheritance to waste like the prodigal son, but all of us know the experience of regret, of looking around at our lives, at our finances maybe, or at our relationships, or our choices, and wondering how we messed up so bad. Somewhere in our stories, there is regret, there is shame, there is desperation. Most of us, I'd say, can't seem to help but to carry a few of those things around with us all the time. But I pray and I hope that when you tell your story, there are pages or paragraphs or sentences at least that speak of forgiveness and of grace. Yes, the kind that you had to work hard for, I hope for that, but also the kind that God gives, the kind that you couldn't earn, because it's not based on how well you made up for mistakes. It's not based on how we could earn it. I hope you haven't just heard about it, but I hope that you have felt prodigal grace. Unexpected, undeserved, incomprehensible grace. The kind of journey that ends in a passionate embrace, like in our scripture, unrestrained welcome. Overwhelming, overflowing joy. It's a surprise party grace. The kind of grace like that, that is for you. That kind of embrace, it is there for you always, whether or not you choose to be held, it is there. And just to throw the question out there, have you ever gotten to give that kind of grace and forgiveness to someone else? The kind that's risky, that costs you something. When you really mean it, when you really mean the grace that you give like that, church, there is no greater joy. It is scandalous. It's a scandalous kind of joy that laughs in the face of others' expectations, and it continues on with the party. Beloveds, this is the heart of God. Scandalous grace and provocative joy. So often we hear God's grace preached and taught as something that we should be ashamed of needing. We are guilted into accepting God's grace out of obligation and fear. Shamed for what we have done in our sin. Friends, that shame and guilt, that is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. If Jesus had preached the gospel as the church so often does, the prodigal son would have spent the rest of his life begging for but never quite receiving his father's forgiveness. That is not the story that Jesus told. Probably because Jesus, being human, Jesus knew how none of us needs any help writing shame and guilt into our own stories. We're pretty good at that, all on our own. What we need help with, what we need to be reminded of, is being welcomed home again and again. We need to be reminded of hope, of joy, Grace, not shame, church. Grace. When I think of the Apostle Paul, I often wonder if he felt shame for his past treatments of those early Jesus followers. They must have, right? The human in me says, you better, right? You should feel bad. I wonder if that's what he was wrestling with during those 3 days after he was blinded during his encounter with the risen Christ on the road to Damascus, but before he regained his sight. Those 3 days where his eyes were blinded, but the eyes of his heart had been opened to his own cruelty, but he had not yet been able to see or receive God's grace. There are pages in all of our stories where we are simply in between the conflict and the resolution, the before and the after. But Saul, the persecutor of Christians, did in fact become Paul, the apostle of Jesus Christ. And in Scripture, we have his testimony. And in his testimony, he tells his whole story. He doesn't get stuck in shame, but tells the whole story. It would have probably been easier for him to pretend to be someone else completely and hide who he had been before, because the rest of the world knew. And the rest of the world had the same reaction that I had. You should be ashamed. But that's not what he did. He did not hide who he was. He could have and still have preached the gospel and talked of God's grace. We know that he must have been persuasive and convincing before he met Jesus. But that's not what he does. Paul tells his whole story. And the parts of his life that we think would have kept him bound in shame and guilt, he holds those up in the light for others to see as evidence of the power of God's grace. Those chains no longer bind him, but he doesn't bury them and pretend they never existed. He carries those broken, shattered chains of his past with him, and he holds them up as he preaches. He says, look what God has done. I once was blind in every sense of the word, but now I see. I once was lost, but God found me. And if God has done this in my life, think what God can do in yours. Church, we all have a story to tell. We all have a testimony. A testimony to give about what God has done. And you may think that you don't have a story that anyone else will want to hear because it's not dramatic enough. Or maybe you're afraid to tell your story, your whole story, because of what others will think of you if they knew. Church, if there's one thing that I am learning as a pastor, if there's one thing that you all are teaching me, as someone who is welcomed into the stories of others, it's that deep down, our stories are the same. We are all human. We are all prone to wonder and to wander. We are all wounded at times, and we all hurt others at times. We all need to be seen and known. And we are all hungry for the embrace of true belonging and acceptance. But before we were any of those things, before we lived our mistakes and our victories, before our longing, before any of those things, we are loved by a God who delights in us and who dwells in every page of our story. So don't be afraid to tell your story, beloveds. Tell your whole story, because it is God's story. Someone needs to hear it. They need to lay their story over top of yours so that they can begin to see God's presence in the pages of their own. Church, what is your story? Hallelujah. Amen. As we turn to our time of prayer together, I want you to find the sheet of paper that you received when you came in. It has the words to one of our beloved hymns, Amazing Grace. Does anybody need one? All right, good. On this sheet of paper, for those of you who are at home, you can do this too. It has the lyrics. It says, I once was blank, but now I'm blank. So take some time as we begin our prayer to think of how you would fill in those blanks. There's no right or wrong way to do this, so let that go. But think about how God has changed you. It could be a specific moment in your life that you think of when you think of something that God did, or it could be a gradual change over many, many years in relationship with God. I once was afraid, but now I'm a little bit braver. I once was angry at the world, but now I'm set free. I once was anxious, but now I'm content. It doesn't have to be something true in every moment from this day until kingdom come. That's not usually how faith works or life. But you have been changed. So I'm going to ask you to put your paper in the offering plate as you leave today. So at the end of worship, because we're going to use them to create a visual testimony of Amity. So you don't have to put your name on it. You can. It's up to you, whatever you'd like to do. But be honest with your prayer. So church, let's begin our time of prayer by writing part of our story of God's grace. Holy God, as we continue through this season of Lent, we're mindful of the lengths that you would go to for the love of your children. We are floating on a sea of grace greater than we can ask or imagine. Lord, we bring to you the cares and the worries of the world. We pray for your world, which you have made and loved, where you are at work for redemption. Lord, help us to walk through a world in need as an open book when it comes to what you have done in our lives and what you are doing and will do. Help us to move and live as people sure of your grace and love, and help us to offer it to all those we meet. Lord, we pray for the leaders of the world, for the leaders of our nation and the leaders of other nations. Your way, Lord, is one of wholeness and peace, and the world longs for that peace, that shalom. Guide them and us to work for the common good of our own nations and the whole world. Lord, shorten the distance between us. Make us whole, Lord. We pray for Charlotte, for the city where we live and that we love. We pray for those in our midst who struggle with the strains of life, and we offer our prayers for them, for those who live with unemployment, underemployment, for those without housing or substandard housing, for those who live with addiction or mental illness, for victims and perpetrators of violence, for those who are lonely and longing for community and belonging. For all of these and for those unnamed, but that you know, Lord, we offer our prayers. You know the measure of grace that is needed in each life. And so we commend our prayers to your care, and we offer to you now in this moment the names and the situations on our hearts. Today we speak them aloud or in the sanctuary of our hearts. Lord, we know that the prayers of your people rise like music to your ears. Lord, we don't neglect praying for ourselves. You've called each of us to live lives marked with your grace, sustained by your power, to be a blessing to your world. We need your inspiration. We need to be sustained, and so we give you thanks for the communities of faith, for this church, Lord, that have guided and nurtured us, and we pray for the church universal. May each of these be the mother of faith, so that our lives can proclaim the one crucified and risen. Lord, hear our prayers as we pray together the words that Jesus gave us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Scripture, Hebrews 13, verse 16. And do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased. This morning, as I was getting dressed to do this, this is probably the most, you know, dressed up that I have been in a couple of months. I was like, oh, I guess we're going to be taking up the 10 cents a meal. And, yep, that's what I found in my bulletin. Well, I know that part of this goes to help with hunger. However, I forgot that it's also programming. It goes for programming for at-risk youth within our presbytery bounds. As part of my job description, when I'm out in that part of the world, I am on a committee that works with youth that are court involved and have substance use disorders. I don't know if any of this money goes towards those youth. However, what those youth have gone through to get them to that point, I'm sure are affected across the board within the presbytery bound. And so your money that you give to 10 cents a meal will be helping these youth, whether it's helping their family find affordable housing, whether it's helping them to determine, whether they are going to pay their rent this month, or are they going to put food on the table. It's also going to be helping to establish programs so that youth who think that they have to go to, like this lady with her gang involvement, to have that family, they've got other resources out there. So please give. Since we are not passing the offering plate right now for COVID safety reasons, you can give to God online through our website or in the offering plate at the back of the sanctuary as you leave. Give to God with joy. Thank you.
I invite you to rise and let's sing the hymn, Amazing Grace. And as you get to that line, I once was, put your own words in there as you sing.
Thank you.
Amen. Beloveds, remember God's amazing grace. It is written into your story in permanent marker, freely given with a wild, uncontainable, scandalous joy. As you go from this place, church, know that the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit that will not let you go, it goes with you now and always. Let's sing our way home.
Peace.